That's right, where it needs to be. If you all stand now, please, and we hear call for worship. Oh God, we can see light, hope, and joy this day.
Oh God, we bring heart, soul, mind, and body to worship.
We share our blessings and our fears.
We bring our faith and our doubts.
With all that we are and all that we am.
Let us worship God.
Please remain standing as we open our songbooks to hymn number 107.
We're going to sing it through twice.
What she said. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the downtrodden. He casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God upon the lyre. Okay, and the this is the word of the Lord. Okay, Mark number 1, verse 29 to 39. Left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law lay sick with a fever, and immediately they told him of her, and he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she served them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered together about the door. And he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many of the demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. And in the morning, a great while before day, he arose and went out to a lonely place. And there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him followed him. They found him and said to him, "Everyone's searching for you." And he said to them, "Let us go on to the next towns, that I may preach there also. For that is why I came out." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. And it is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now with the verse of "Jesus Loves Me," you'll have the pleasure of joining the kids.
I was hungry and you gave me food, thirsty and you gave me drink, Whenever you did this for one of the least of these followers of mine, you did it for me. Amen.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
So I brought a picture with me today, and I wanted to know if any of you guys know who this guy is. It's Waldo. What does Waldo do? He hides, he travels, and he hides because it's a fun thing. Whoops, wrong way. It's a fun thing to try to find Waldo, isn't it? And I already found him because, you know, I had to look earlier. Do you guys know where he is? I know it's a very small picture, but the wonderful thing about technology is, unlike in the day when we just had a book, you can enlarge it and find Waldo. Do you see him here in this picture? Right there? Yeah. It's fun searching for Waldo, isn't it? But in real life, is it fun searching for someone who's maybe lost? You guys ever been lost? Or has your parents ever been lost? One time when Jacob was little, he got lost in Walmart, which happened every time he went there. But this time he was gone for a long, long time, and my mom found him. And the women's dressing room and the back one locked up kind of all by himself. And she looked at him and she said, "Jacob, are you lost?" And he said, "No, but my mom is." That was a typical Jacob response. But anyway, it's kind of scary when you're looking for someone who's maybe lost, isn't it, in real life? Not a game with Waldo. And in our scriptures this morning, we heard that people were looking for Jesus. And Jesus had been traveling around and healing people. He was becoming very popular because he was healing all these people and casting out demons. And he went to the home of Simon Peter, and his mother-in-law was very sick with a fever, and he healed her instantly. And she got up, and she made dinner for them. We can all relate to that, can't we? And then he went outside, and he healed a bunch of people. And the next morning, when he got up, he had gone to be alone to pray to God, and people started looking for him. And he told the disciples that they needed to move on to another city or another town so he could continue to preach and spread the good news of God. But you know what? People today are still looking for Jesus. There are people in this world who don't know about Jesus, or maybe who have known Jesus but have fallen away, and they're still looking for them, for him. But Jesus tells us, and the Bible tells us, that if we look for God with our whole body and our whole soul, we can find him. So just remember that if you ever feel lost and away from God, that you just have to turn back to him. Where you are, just turn around and say, "God, I'm here. I love you," and he's there with you again. Let's say a prayer.
Dear God,
we know there are many
in the world today
looking for your son.
Help them
find him today.
Okay, thanks a lot for that message, for that information in terms of thinking about people as they search for Jesus. And there are lots of us that continue to search for Jesus each and every day. This is quite a story that we heard in our New Testament reading, our gospel reading from Mark this morning, about Jesus. If we remember the very beginning of what this says, it says, immediately Jesus went to the house of Simon and Andrew. Now, the reason it says immediately, because right before that, what was going on is that Jesus was preaching and teaching in the synagogue. We read that last Sunday, and I talked about that a little bit. Jesus was preaching and teaching there on the Sabbath. And so immediately after that, he went to the house of Simon and Andrew. So it's still the Sabbath. The Sabbath, of course, to the Hebrew people, the Sabbath was the last day of the week. It was the day in which God rested after he had spent 6 days creating the world. And the Sabbath to the Hebrews was Saturday, as Sunday was the first day of the week. So we know that this was a Saturday. It was the Sabbath. And Jesus went to the house of Simon and Andrew. And unfortunately, as soon as he got there, he discovered or he heard that Simon's mother-in-law was ill with a fever. She was ill with a fever on this Sabbath day. But Jesus went to her immediately and healed her, which was a little bit of a problem in and of itself, because Jesus, as a healer, according to Hebrew law and Hebrew tradition, on this Saturday, the Sabbath, was not supposed to be doing any work. And healing was considered an act of work. So Jesus was actually breaking one of the Sabbath laws by healing Simon's mother-in-law on this particular day when he went to Simon's house. However, as we've already heard from Joan, he had to do this because she had to get up and fix the meal and take care of them and serve them. Because evidently she was the female head of household in this particular home, and so it was her job to act as hostess. But if she was so ill with this fever, she would not have been able to do that. So Jesus healed her. And then we hear the rest of this particular part of the story where other people heard that Jesus had come to Simon and Andrew's house. They knew that Jesus was there, and it's interesting that it does mention in this particular passage that the other people, who would have been Hebrew people, waited until after dark. They waited until sundown to come to Simon's house, and the reason they did that, of course, was because at sundown, the Sabbath was over. And so the healer could have done work after sundown. And that's why Jesus then is healing all of these people after dark at Simon and Andrew's house. And so we don't know, because it doesn't tell us in the scriptures, what kind of illnesses and sicknesses Jesus was healing. He probably was healing those who were lame, those perhaps that had leprosy. He probably was healing others, just like Simon's mother-in-law, who also had a fever, and he was healing those fevers as well. So it doesn't seem to have mattered whether the people like Simon's mother-in-law had a Saturday day fever or whether they had a Saturday night fever. Jesus still healed them. Oh, you got it. Okay. Hoping everybody, at least over 45, had that Saturday night fever. John Travolta. That was my feeble attempt at doing this one. I was a movie, John Travolta, when he was like a teenager, and he extended it. Yeah, it was before he was born. So. Okay, let's go on. It also says in this passage that they brought to him all who were sick, and he healed many who were sick with various diseases, not just fevers, but with various diseases. And if we think about that, wouldn't that have been wonderful if you had a bad back? You just go to Simon's house and Jesus was there and he healed you. If you had the flu and you could get up and get there, you could go to Jesus at Simon's house and he would heal you. Regardless of what malady you had, you would go and Jesus would heal you. I mean, that's even better than Obamacare, right? As a matter of fact, maybe we could call this like Jesus care. Jesus care. And it's a lot better than Obamacare, because Jesus is not going to raise your deductibles or your premiums at all. You just go and... Okay. Let's just go on with the message. Thinking about Jesus and thinking about healing, all throughout the Gospels, there are many, many instances of Jesus healing people, right? I mean, this is one of the earliest ones in Mark. It's in Mark 1 that we find Jesus healing people. But all throughout his ministry, Jesus is healing people. And that's one of the things that draws so many people in to Jesus, is because he's healing them of all kinds of diseases. Well, that was 2,000 years ago, and Jesus was healing all those people. The question that I have today, or one of the questions that I have today, is why isn't Jesus still healing people in the same way that he did 2,000 years ago? If you've got a fever, if you've got the flu, if you've got some illness, why doesn't Jesus just heal all of us that have those kind of maladies today? This whole issue of healing, you know? So many people in the Gospels were healed back then, 2,000 years ago. What's the difference today? Doesn't the Bible say that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever? Yeah, it does. Doesn't that include us today? You know, why don't we get the same kind of healing from Jesus as those people had so many years ago? That's our question for today. And spoiler alert to all of you, if you look at the title of the message for this morning, you might guess how I'm going to answer that question. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of all our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Healings. Why aren't there healings like that today? Now don't worry. I'm not going to go all Benny Hinn on you this morning. Benny Hinn, how many of you have ever heard of Benny Hinn? Do you know who Benny Hinn is, what I'm talking about? He's one of the great faith healers in the Christian tradition of the late 20th and beginning of the 21st century. He's still around. I think we looked him up. How old was he, Richard? I think he's still in, he's only in his late 60s. Something. He was born in 52. That would make him 65, 66, yeah. Okay, Benny Hinn, he's still around. He used to go on tour, I don't know if he still does this or not, and would fill up auditoriums of people and have these faith healing worship experiences that he would have. And Benny Hinn would come in, and he's famous for, if you've ever seen him, for smoting people on the head, you know, whatever their calamity is, smotes them, and then they fall backwards into the arms of his people there, and then they go to the floor, and then they're healed of their diseases. So I'm not going to call anybody up this morning. You're okay. We're not going to do that. I'm not going to go Benny Hinn on you here, because I really believe, and this is my belief, that those so-called faith healers, even in the Christian tradition like Benny Hinn, that they're not really healers. Even Benny Hinn will tell you, that I've seen interviews with him where he says, I'm not really a healer. It's God's power that's going through me that heals these people. It's not my power, Benny Hinn says. He says it's God's power that flows through him to heal these people. Maybe that's how things work, but when I read the Bible, nowhere in the Bible can I see where it says Benny Hinn is going to have any special powers to let God's power go through him to heal people. I don't really think that he has that extraordinary capability to do that. I think it's truly only God that has that power to do that kind of healing. But that still leaves us with the problem of, why don't we see all these miraculous healings today like they did back in Jesus' time? How come that doesn't happen here in the 21st century? Well, if you listen to the faith healing crowd, those who believe in faith healers today, they say that we don't see all those miraculous types of healings as much today because we just don't have enough faith. And more specifically, they say it's because the sick people don't have enough faith to get healed. If only they believed harder, they could be healed. Or it could be because of that unconfessed sin that they have in their life that they haven't admitted to yet, or it's just simply that they're not obedient enough. If only they would get rid of their sin, and if only they would obey God, and if only they would live a holy life, then God would give them their healing. What a bunch of high-pressure, non-Christian garbage that kind of thinking is. The Bible doesn't tell us anything of the sort. But we do get those kinds of explanations from a lot of faith healers today. Just not enough faith. If you had enough faith, you could be healed. But no, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible doesn't say a person's lack of faith or lack of obedience to God is why people don't get healed. Okay, so what about it? What's the answer to my question that I posed? Why are there not miraculous healings today? Well, one answer that sort of gets at it a little bit is this one. God does provide healings today, and He does it through modern medicine and doctors. Well, I think there's a grain of truth in that line of thinking. Because, you know, God has indeed granted human beings with this marvelous brain. And we've used that brain that's led to great advances in knowledge, and particularly on the part of scientists and doctors, that has helped us with our health, particularly a lot in the last couple of centuries. We know that's true, and we thank God for it. Our life expectancy is so much greater today than it's ever been at any time in human history because of all that medical knowledge and advances. Since Jesus' time, in the past 2,000 years, there have been tremendous strides made in curing people of their illnesses, of their sicknesses, of whatever it is that may physically ail them. So there is that. God is giving some types of healings through advanced medical care. And that's a blessing. That's a blessing that we enjoy today, and I think we should thank God for that. And yet, we also know that sometimes, every once in a while, I know you've all heard of them, some of you may have experienced it, God does a healing that we have no explanation for. The doctors can't explain it. The doctors did not cause it through anything that they did with all their advanced medicine, with all their advanced knowledge. The healing just comes out of the blue, literally. People may have prayed to God and the person was healed. That does happen. And we know it does. All of us in some way have experienced that, if not in our lives, in the lives of people that we know, or at least that we've read about and that we've heard about. That does happen. And you know, sometimes God even provides healing without prayers being spoken. That happens as well. That's just the way God is. God surprises us with God's mercy. And we have to thank God for it. And we have to realize that that's a blessing, and we praise the Lord. But now I want to suggest something else to get at the answer to my question. Something else to go along with the other couple of things that I've said so far. If we ask, why doesn't Jesus do these healings today? Well, my friends, I'm going to let you in on a little secret that perhaps is not that much of a secret to you. I believe Jesus still does healings today. Only maybe not exactly in the same manner that were described in the gospel lesson that we read this morning. Because if you think about it, consider what happened to all those people that Jesus healed, not just in our scripture this morning, but in all those gospel stories that we have. If we added them all up, there had to have been thousands and thousands of people that Jesus healed according to our gospel lessons. Well, they were all healed by Jesus, yes, but they all have something else in common as well. As we look back on this now in retrospect, 2,000 years later. Now, Jesus healed them all, but all of those people who were healed by Jesus, every single one of them, they would all, sooner or later, get sick with something else, or simply grow old and die. Every single one of them. Every single person that Jesus healed died. Wait a minute, Pastor Steve. Are you telling me that Jesus' supernatural powers weren't strong enough? That there was an expiration date on his miracles? No, that wasn't it. Here's the deal. And I think this is important for us to understand all the miracle accounts that we read about in the Gospels. Those healings that we read about in the Gospels, the healings done by Jesus were signs. They were signs that were pointing to the eternal blessings that Jesus was bringing. They're pointing to the kingdom of heaven that Jesus was bringing to us on this earth. Do you realize that the people of Jesus' time did not have the Gospels? They didn't have the New Testament stories or any of the New Testament that we have today to explain to them, to talk to them about Jesus and who he was and what he did and why he lived. No, what they had was Jesus himself as their gospel message. And these healings that Jesus did, that he performed during his lifetime, they pointed ahead to what was to be, toward the ultimate healing that Jesus was in the process of accomplishing through his life, and particularly through his death and his resurrection. And that ultimate healing was certainly not limited to the folks back then. That ultimate healing is for all of us that have ever lived since that time, all of God's children. So it's for all of us too. Every one of us here today, Jesus loves you and me, each one of us, just as much as Jesus loved any of the people that he healed back when he was walking on this earth. Jesus comes to provide healing for all of us. So how does that happen? How does Jesus do that? How does Jesus gain healing for all of us? Well, he did that by dealing with the root problem that causes the misery and the heartbreak in this earthly world. Jesus gains that ultimate healing for us, gains our eternal healing by dealing with our sin. Sin. Yeah, we talked about it in confirmation class this morning. As human beings, we all sin. This general sinful condition that pervades the human world, it pervades the human world ever since God gave Adam and Eve, and thus all human beings who ever lived, the freedom to choose. And since we have the freedom to choose, we human beings sometimes choose sin. As a matter of fact, at some time or another, we all choose to sin. And Jesus came to fix this condition that we have, to heal us of this particular problem, which he did by carrying our sins on his body to the cross. Jesus Christ dealt decisively with our sin. When the Son of God shed his holy blood for the sins of the whole world, I think that's pretty big medicine. That was medicine for us. As Isaiah 53 says, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And upon him was the chastisement that made us whole. And with his stripes, we are healed. Do you know that? Do you know that Jesus Christ died and suffered on that cross for your sins? Your sins. Your sin of not loving God. Your sin of not hearing and heeding God's word. Your sin of wanting to be your own God. Your sin of wanting to make your own decisions about what is right and wrong. Your sin of lack of love for your neighbor, your sin of being jealous of your neighbor's success, your sin of gossip, your sin of greed, your sin of selfishness. Yes, those are your sins that Jesus is bearing while he bleeds and dies on that cross. But that fact that Jesus is bearing those sins, that Jesus is shedding his blood for those sins, that means that Christ on the cross is purchasing your healing and my healing. It's guaranteed. It's a done deal. Sins forgiven means that your sins are lifted. Your sins are healed. Your sins are gone. Resurrection is ahead. Healing is ahead for you. Forever. It's as good and as sure and as solid as Christ's own resurrection, which we're going to celebrate on Easter, just a few weeks away. It's yours through faith in him. God shares God's gifts with you. You are healed. How does that happen? Last thing I want to say this morning. Well, how does that happen? How do the gifts of God get delivered to your door? To you, right where you live, with your name on it? Well, I really believe that's where the ongoing ministry of the church comes in. Word and sacrament. You've heard that phrase many times before. Word and sacrament, right? Word and sacrament. That's really not a church cliche. That is God's delivery system to you. Sending the gifts that Christ won for you, the healing that Christ provides for you, and getting them to where you live. Forgiveness, life, salvation. Healing of the soul, and yes, healing of the body, too. Right here in the church, in hearing the word, you get the gospel read and you get it preached into your ears every Sunday. And hopefully you hear and receive that good news with glad hearts. But on top of that, God also blesses us with the sacraments. And our two sacraments are Holy Baptism, Holy Communion. And that's where we get the physicality of it all. The sacraments are applied to our bodies. In Holy Baptism, it's the water splashed over our body. And a few weeks ago, we had the opportunity to remember our baptisms right here at this baptismal font. I hope some of you still have your stones that you took with you to remember your baptism and to keep it holy. And in the Lord's Supper, of course, it's the bread and the cup, the body and the blood of Christ, which we receive into our physical bodies. We will approach this table and celebrate together the sacrament of communion next Sunday, right here, right in this place. So the sacraments that we receive are physical elements because we're physical people. We have bodies, people whom Christ has redeemed in both soul and in body, both in soul and in body. And so, my dear friends, rejoice that Jesus is not stingy in doling out the blessings of God's kingdom. Jesus does have healing for you today, body and soul. So come to where Jesus is doing his thing. Wait, you're already here. Right here where Jesus is doing his thing, so is he. Because Jesus comes today with healing for you and for me. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us now respond to our word this morning by singing together our hymn of response, which is your white insert that you had in your bulletin this morning. It is "There Is a Balm in Gilead," which I think is probably familiar to many of us. So let us now rise together and sing our hymn of response. Please join with me now in that great Christian affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, which we find printed in bulletin this morning. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sit on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We now come to that part in our service where we have the opportunity to give back of what we have. The many ways that we've been blessed in our lives are too numerous to account. But we know that God asks us to be generous as we do our best to extend his ministry and to continue to establish his kingdom here on this earth. So as our ushers come forward, and as our choir provides us with our special music this morning, I ask that you be generous in your gifts. Gracious God, we know that you do hear our prayers. And so this morning we pray that these tokens that we present now before you may be used to continue to spread your kingdom throughout this world, so that others may learn and know to lift their prayers to you as well as they follow in the ways of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pause now for just a moment of silence as we prepare our hearts and minds for prayer. Shall we pray? Our Lord and our God, we know that tragedies abound in this world. Our newspapers, our television newscasts, our Facebook posts, the media all around report so many troubling happenings in our world. Random people shot and killed. Ongoing strife and warfare in many areas of the world. School shootings. Starvation and disease still rampant in the 21st century. And we are caught up in the midst of all this chaos. So calm our spirits, our God. Help us to focus on the love that you have given to us in Jesus Christ. Remind us again that his healing mercies extend to us this day, as surely as they did to those people long ago. We have gathered on this day to hear your word, to be forgiven, and to be healed, and to find ways in which we may serve you in peace. And we have lifted up names of those near and dear to us who stand in need of your healing mercy and your compassionate love. Some names we have spoken out loud, others we still are just uttering in our hearts. But you have heard all our prayers, our God. You know our needs and our concerns even before our voices can frame them. So allow us to accept the love that you give to all. Empower us to take that love and to use it for good in your world, because we know that we are your vessels for good in this world. So let the message of hope and compassion go forth from us to this world which too often focuses on tragedy and turmoil. And once again, our God, let us know fully that you are with us as together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Let us now rise one last time, either in body or in spirit, and sing together our closing hymn. this place, don't forget. Your dollar, at least, is that what you said? It's in our... Oh, Logan's got a soup bowl back there in the back. Okay, so he's ready for your contributions that we need to make to the Super Bowl of Care Sunday. It may seem like just a little bit to drop a dollar or two in, but it goes a long way for helping those who are in need. So if you can participate in this as we leave this day, it would be greatly appreciated. Whatever you're doing today, whether you watch the Super Bowl or you're finding something actually fun and exciting to do, remember, like eating the food at the Super Bowl, that would be a good thing. Remember that God is always with you, because God is always above us. God is always below us. God always goes before us. God always goes behind us. God always stands right beside us. And most importantly of all, God is always inside us as well. So go in peace this day, my friends. Come back next Sunday when we celebrate the Lord's Supper. Amen.